Hey everybody, this is Work in Progress, an art gallery of Greater Victoria podcast where you'll hear from artists, staff, collaborators, and even different hosts as we go behind the scenes to explore AGGV projects in progress. I'm Marina DiMaio, the Digital Assets Coordinator at the AGGV and your host for this episode.
The AGGV is located on the unceded traditional territories of the Lekwungen-speaking peoples, today known as the Esquimalt and Songhees Nations. And that's where I'm zooming in from today. But for the purposes of this episode, we'll also be hearing from folks who are joining from Dish With One Spoon territory, as well as Treaty 6 territory. I'd like to begin by welcoming several staff from Tangled Arts and Disability, including Kayla, who is the Public Education Coordinator, Sean, who is the Director of Programming, and Francis, who is the Communications Coordinator. And I'd also like to welcome Connor, who is one of the external consultants who supported Tangled with a digital accessibility audit, looking closely at some of the AGGV's virtual spaces. Welcome, everyone. Perhaps we could start by having each of you introduce yourselves and share a little bit about your work at Tangled or beyond.
This is Kayla speaking. Marina, thanks for having us today. My name is Kayla Bessie. I am Tangled's Public Education Coordinator, so that makes me one half of our communications team with Francis here. And we do all the digital communications at the gallery, as well as educational resource creation and sharing. And I also co-host a podcast of our own at Tangled called Crypt Times.
I can go next. I'm Frances Tompkins. I'm the communications coordinator at Tangled. So I'm the other half of our communications team. And I do the things that Kayla described as well. And something else we do as a comms team is occasionally work with other galleries or arts institutions and let them know about some of the ways that we make our communications more accessible at Tangled and kind of explore ways with them that they can make their communications accessible as well.
My name's Sean Lee. I'm the director of programming at Tangled. So a lot of what I do is kind of around the programming aspects, organizing our exhibitions and kind of thinking through the overall long-term goals of the organization. And yeah, that is me. And I'll pass it over to you, Connor.
All right. Well, thank you, everyone. I'm Connor. I'm here in Edmonton, Alberta, which is on Treaty 6 territory. I'm a deaf queer artist. I'm a creator, a writer, and a performer, amongst many other things. I also do communications advisory work, public relations, and I also look at accessibility audits, which is something I have just completed here with Tangled Arts and AGGV. So that would be me in a nutshell.
Amazing. Thank you so much, everyone. So I guess what I wanted to do is just start the podcast episode with a bit of a shout out to the Feminist Art Field School. For those people who might be listening to this podcast, the Feminist Art Field School was a previous AGGV program that was co-curated by Michelle Jakes and Chase Joint. And that's where I personally first heard Sean talk about Tangled Arts and the wonderful work that you're doing there. Sean was one of the special guests in the field school. So that's something that you can listen back to at any point in time on our YouTube channel. And you'll hear Sean, Chase, and Michelle talk about things like critical access, accessible curating, access intimacy was an idea that was talked about in that episode that was really interesting as well, and kind of a highlight for myself. But more recently, the AGGV has had the opportunity to reconnect with Tangled on a digital accessibility project. And we've been calling it a mini digital accessibility audit because, you know, digital tools are always changing. So there's always a need to kind of reevaluate, to revisit digital accessibility. And because everyone has different access needs, right? So digital accessibility is very expansive and always ongoing. And so what we were hoping to do today is reflect a little bit on this project, on this mini digital accessibility audit. And what we were trying to do was create a really, or what we hoped to do was create a really non-hierarchical process, a project that wasn't necessarily just directed by AGGV. So we began by inviting Sean, Kayla, and Francis to kind of explore, critique from an outside perspective, a variety of the AGGV's virtual channels. And we decided to focus on some of our more highly used channels, like the website, the AGGV magazine, Instagram, Facebook, and YouTube. Then Sean, Kayla, and Francis invited two additional consultants. Danica, who isn't able to join us today, shared specific feedback from a lived blind and low vision perspective. And Connor, who is with us today, shared actionable feedback on AGGV's digital platforms from a lived deaf perspective. So that's a very kind of basic summary, I guess, of the project. And so I was curious to open up to all of you and just ask how you decided to respond to this open-ended process. I'm curious if anybody would be willing to summarize for podcast listeners where you took this original invitation and what unfolded for you.
This is Sean. I can maybe start, and Francis, Kayla, Connor, feel free to jump in at any point. But I think for us, this was a really great opportunity to engage with a platform as consultants from the perspective of kind of a lateral way of thinking, kind of a horizontal way of thinking. In particular, like we've Tangled is often approached as almost like the quote unquote experts. And I think we want to move away from that sort of binary way of thinking of, you know, there are the experts and then those who are kind of receiving that knowledge. And we instead wanted to approach this recognizing that we all come to it with different lived experiences. And so an important part of this was bringing, you know, outside consultants into this fold and recognizing that we're not necessarily representing, you know, our community with a single perspective, but rather approaching it as our own experience of these platforms. And I think for us, it was really interesting to develop kind of the different goals and the different ways that we're approaching these platforms, because they can so often be very inherently inaccessible, and we've encountered that a lot. But I think, you know, to give credit to the AGGV, and particular to Reagan Shum, who had done a lot of work before, we were quite, I think, pleasantly surprised when approaching this. And so we felt that we were able to bring in outside consultants to sort of come at it from a very like open place, not needing to create a lot of like, okay, here's like where the problems we think are. Like I don't feel like we needed to create too much of a backstory in some ways. We were able to just approach it openly. And I think to its credit, that's because of the work that was already done by, you know, disability arts workers. And in particular, you know, I think Reagan Shrum did a lot. Reagan, you know, I think being a past guest, I wanted to just give a bit of a shout out to that. And I don't know if Francis, Kayla, Connor, you want to add to that?
Yeah, Sean, I love what you said about not being positioned as the experts and being able to approach the project from kind of like a peer way. I think something that we often come up against when we're doing this type of consultation work is being asked for a sort of checklist or a like a one size fits all approach to accessibility, where we can sort of just deliver these 10 things that you need to do and then you'll be accessible. And accessibility doesn't usually work that way. So this was a really fun project for me because, you know, we're really used to working in the accessible communication realm. So there are certain things that we kind of suggest every time, such as image descriptions or captioning videos or things like that. But it was great to be able to explore this project and see things that, for me at least, I was really inspired by, like, seeing that the hashtag WIP podcast had ASL interpretation and that the ASL was split screen with the podcast was something that was really exciting and that I hadn't seen before. So that was something that I wouldn't even necessarily have thought to suggest, but it was something that I got to learn from and kind of built on my ideas of what could be done in accessible communications. So that was really great.
I just wanted to add on some of my experiences as well. I basically showed up, did my work, and then I left. There wasn't a chance to have follow-up dialogue based on what I had found. So it's nice to have that. The time I spent looking through the platform, the website, and whatever issues I came across was great. It really empowered me to give specific feedback. The AGGV has already done a lot of great things in terms of accessibility, and that was fantastic to see. It made me realize this organization is on the right path and they're going to get to where they need to be. It was just nice to see that and recognize it, you know, basically saying good job, pat on the back for this. And now there's other ways we could actually expand upon this and make it better. I think that's a better approach than, well, here's your report. You're not doing this, you're not doing that, and you're missing this. So here you go. Have fun for the next 2 years, making it more accessible. I didn't really think that was the best approach. I just think, you know, it's important to be involved, and that's not the right way to advocate. So I didn't want to be that harsh person to show up and go, hey, here's what's the problem. So this was a different experience. This was nice. And really, I was impressed. And I am really excited to see where things are headed to from here.
Yeah, I think as you've all noted, we weren't starting from zero access with AGGV. There's so much excellent work that had already been done. And I think something that is important to remind ourselves, or I would remind anybody, if you are starting to think about access in your digital spaces for the first time, is that these platforms don't make access intuitive, and you often have to get creative and hack it or crip it in some way. For example, Twitter only very recently made it so that alt text is visible to all users if it's there on an image, rather than just for those using screen readers. So while we wait for these social media like giants to do the least, honestly, there are strategies that we can employ when we work together and when, as has been said, we don't get one approach or one person as an expert, but rather get creative and kind of playful about how we can work within these like ecosystems that we already have in order to invite access into those spaces.
Thank you all for sharing those thoughts. I think, you know, part of the hope for this podcast episode as well was to be able to share a little bit about this process so that if there are other museums or galleries that want to kind of draw some inspiration or structure from it, that they could, you know, maybe listen back and take something away for themselves. Because like you said, digital access is not just about compliance. Like, it's not just a checklist. And I guess what I'm trying to say is that, you know, each organization is very different. And so the approach that the AGGV is going to have to take might look a little bit different for the types of programs that we're doing. But the hope is that we can kind of draw some threads of continuity within this discussion as well. And so I think that relates to my next question a little bit, which is thinking to the future. I'm curious, how do you imagine that we can further amplify and extend the work that began within this preliminary digital accessibility audit? I'm curious to hear from any of you or all of you what you think institutions like the AGGV can learn from this process, and if you have any tips or suggestions for other galleries in terms of approaching digital accessibility.
I know on my end, as I gave it some thought, I think a suggestion did come to mind. When an organization is trying to become accessible for their clients, their consumers, or for the population at large, I think that's a step in the right direction, right? We just want to make sure, you know, because we're setting up this information and this is for you. And yes, we want to make sure it is being accessed. We also have to think about what accessibility looks like and what the priorities would be, right? Like when you wake up in the morning, what's your first thought about how to make things more accessible? You know, put your mind in it right from the beginning and really make sure it's there. And again, the how part of that, right? So I think you have to start with each organization on its own internally. The people of that organization need to think about haven't we been fully accessible up to this point? For example, myself as a deaf artist, if I was working there, we have a lot of interpreting services available. We would have blogs and ASL to really increase accessibility for the deaf community, but that's because I'm working there and I'm kind of spearheading that. So that's what I'm talking about, is when you look at your organization, who's missing? Who's not at the table, and who can we bring to that table for accessibility? So I know for me, I felt that was a really strong point. I think the organization can make that change when you think about who's not there. Now, I don't mean just start onboarding new staff. That's not necessarily the answer. I think we need to have a conversation first. Look at our current team. Who's here? Who's not here? Right. And to think about where things have been up to this point, go, you know what, we really should have this, we really should have that. This hasn't always been available. You know, I think it's stuff that maybe we already know, but accessibility is waiting, right? And the community at large won't know. So I think we got to have that internal dialogue first and grow from that. And I think that will make us ready and, you know, be like really geared up to make this change happen. So that's just one offering I would bring for AGGV, plus whoever else might be listening to this podcast right now. If you have the power to do that and get that first meeting going, I would say please do.
This is Kayla again. A face that I don't know who exactly to attribute this to. In my experience, I think it comes out of the relaxed performance communities, which is when thinking and talking about access, if you build it, they might come, by which I mean, you can't expect to just, for example, okay, we've done ASL vlogs now, or we have translation, or we have audio description. But if you don't adequately share and publicize, advertise and do outreach to those communities, they're not going to know that they've been invited in. And there might be a period of frustration or disappointment that the disability community is maybe not engaging or hanging out with you in the ways that you might expect. So access does not automatically equal access to community. So I think step one is doing these technical pieces and learning these practical skills for access. And a really important ongoing step is that relationship building piece so that you can be in dialogue and in genuine relationship with disability and deaf communities.
Yeah, those are both really great points. I think something I would add to that is patience and commitment to keeping up with whatever access features you've committed to, even if you're not seeing like a quote unquote return on investment in your audience participation right away. Because if I'm a community member and I need a certain access feature to be able to come to your space and enjoy what you're offering, and I'm told that that's going to be there, if I show up and it's not there, chances are you've lost me. Like, I am probably not going to want to engage in your space in the future. So, you know, if you're promising something to a community, having that be a really strong commitment is great. And I think part of that is to have it be an institutional decision. So not just one department or not just one, event, but really have it be a commitment that's across the board.
I just want to echo what everyone else is saying. And I think access, you know, is a part of disability culture, right? These practices are motivated to really allow disability to shape culture rather. And I think we can't just use accessibility as this way to slide disabled folks into normative practices. And so as you build your access, I think it's for me, the sort of next step inherently is to bring the community in and to allow us to make those choices and the aesthetic choices around access rather than be dictated how access is kind of given to us, you know.
Yeah, thank you all for all of those thoughts. I really, really appreciate what you said about relationship building and commitment and consistency. I also feel like a lot of capacity around digital accessibility and digital content and digital engagement and digital programming was built throughout the pandemic, right? So many museums were online. And so I guess part of what we're asking is, how can we hold on to these new access features in meaningful ways and not let them fade away? And also like how we can make them better. And then I guess juggling that with the fact that at least in the AGGV's experience, our capacity has shifted over the years. And we've been able to offer different access features at different points in time. So my follow-up question then is, in your opinion, what are some of the best ways for arts organizations to disseminate and to foreground and to promote their current access features? And I guess the related question is, how can arts organizations create a warm and welcoming feel in digital spaces for disabled audiences?
Honestly, as someone from the deaf community, and this might actually spill over to other disabled. But honestly, I would say if you are providing food, people are going to come. Flat out. It's there. So, I mean, if you're having an event, it's a social gathering, it's mingle, interpreters are there for access to sign language, almost run like an open house, you know? So maybe a small presentation about here's what we've been doing to really improve our accessibility. And, you know, I think something like that would be great as well, but make it kind of a social event. So that way the space, it has an active feel for it, and the deaf community would want to come. People are like, wow, that was a really good night. I can't believe they did this, you know, and they're doing something else again next month. I think I'm going to come back to this because it had that feeling to it. So, I mean, right, almost like a party, I would say, right? I mean, you know, Debbie, we party too. And I mean, if we want to wear masks, let's wear masks, but we like to do that too. So, I mean, I don't think we need to reinvent the wheel here. Sometimes something simple like this to get the community involved, it really does work. So, and I think one event might be not be enough, maybe have a couple of events or have it annually, so we kind of always have that same feeling getting refreshed as we go along.
I think one thing that I would really like to see more art spaces start doing is telling us, being more upfront, if you have an event or a program or something, about what kind of access features are in that program, but also what access features aren't in that program. It's really difficult when you need a certain access feature to engage with a space and you're online and looking at the event posting or Facebook post, and you just can't find any information about whether that feature is present. And this can help open a conversation with communities as well, because you're showing that you have an awareness that, you know, you still have work to do, or you're being transparent about the types of resources that you do have or where you're at as an institution. I think sometimes galleries or institutions are kind of afraid to do this because they don't want to look like they don't care or they're doing something wrong. But that type of transparency can actually be really helpful. Another thing to kind of work off Connor's point is, yeah, if you have food at your opening or your event, people will come. And I think this is part of accessibility too. Like, if we can open up our concept of what access is to include sort of that element of intersectionality. Like, we know that disabled people are disproportionately affected by poverty, unfortunately. So having food at your events is access. Having free childcare at your events is access. You know, having events that don't have a cover charge is access. So yeah, having like a more broad sense of what accessibility is as well is really helpful. And inviting to a lot of folks.
This is kind of a bit of a follow-up question. What would be the equivalent to providing food at a digital event?
That's a great question. Tangled did this once during the pandemic. I believe it was in December, like over the holiday season. 2020. So we weren't gathering in person at all. And we would have normally had an end of year, some kind of food-based event. But because that didn't feel safe and accessible to our community, Tangled provided us all with money to order whatever takeout we wanted to have together. And we gathered on Zoom and we still shared mealtime and space and social time. So I know depending on the size of the event, that might not always be feasible, but I've thought a lot actually about the money that large institutions have probably not spent on hospitality over the pandemic, because their idea of hospitality is so narrow in, oh, it's catering in a physical space and it's cheese and crackers and alcohol. But if you could give each person even $10, to get themselves a treat to sit on a digital event with you, that would be an incredible offering if that was, you know, in the budget. And making that time for like loose engagement and like casual socialization when it can feel like our time is so regimented when everything's on Zoom and so rigidly organized, like still leaving that space for a feeling of casual encounter and into somebody when you both like go to grab a snack or whatever.
Yeah, I was also going to point to our hashtag Crip Ritual exhibition that happened. It was the last exhibition we had, which opened in January of 2021. And we developed a bit of like a care package for folks who were visiting because, you know, we were kind of open in a hybrid model. Folks were welcome to physically come to the space to experience our exhibition, but we could also do a remote Zoom tour where essentially folks were brought into the gallery through Zoom. It was very DIY. You know, we did it on like an iPad on a tripod with wheels, and we just essentially gave folks an experience of coming into the gallery digitally. And we were able to, you know, give tours that way. We were able to do audio description that way. We were able to bring in ASL interpreters if needed for these kind of one-on-one meetings. And at the end of it, because often in our shows we have some sort of sensory experience or some sort of takeaway, we wanted to expand on what that could look like. And so we created these relatively humble care packages. You know, I would have a button and a takeaway with like a little zine and maybe a packet of tea for folks to just kind of, you know, read through the zine and enjoy a cup of tea and, you know, take a button with them. So I felt like that was sort of an equivalent in some ways, maybe not equivalent, but another way of engaging, you know, the senses digitally. And it was really well received, I think, from the community. And in fact, some folks said that they preferred the remote version of coming to the show over physically coming in person.
I love all those ideas. And I kind of love how you answered my question about what's the digital equivalent to food with food, right? Like nothing can replace it. To be able to create that around the dinner table kind of feel. I think, yeah, you're absolutely right. But that's just, it's just a part of experience that we need to not abandon just because we're in engaging in digital spaces. So I love all of those thoughts. And I think those ideas about care packages, gifts, takeout or money for food are all wonderful ideas. And why not, right? Like what is the responsibility of larger institutions to engage in these ways? Just, I guess, an open-ended question. I'm kind of thinking about something that's switching gears a little bit, but it's something that you mentioned, Kayla, in one of our previous meetings that I would love to expand on, if you're willing. And it has to do with this idea of writing and barriers to writing, things relating to image descriptions and alt text. The question that's come up at the AGGV is, are there ways to use language that is specific to blind or low vision experiences? Like, is there a course that we need to take? What if we do it wrong? But you brought up this idea when we were talking last time about alt text as poetry. And so I'm really interested to hear you expand on that idea for podcast listeners about how digital access can be both practical and creative at the same time.
Absolutely. Happy to talk about that. Yeah. First of all the credit to Shannon Finnegan and Bojana Cochlea. Am I saying their name properly? Yes. For creating the alt text as poetry resources that all of us at Tangled know and love. So they are both disabled artists who have created this resource that I encourage everyone to look up. I believe it's alttextaspoetry.net. And the ethos of alt text as poetry is that, no, you can't really do it wrong. I mean, you will get better at alt text with practice, but I like to think in the simplest terms, okay, if I'm looking at an image, or imagine I'm standing in a gallery looking at a painting, how would I describe it to a blind friend who is with me, right beside me, if they ask me to describe it in my own words? So I think leaning into subjectivity can be a really beautiful creative choice, and not trying to just be so literal and objective, because art, of course, is so subjective. So while you might describe the physical characteristics, colors, textures of a piece, you might also be a little more abstract and say, oh, it gives me a feeling of, you know, being warm or whatever it might be, and draw on other sensory experiences or other metaphors even that get across the felt sense of a piece, or the size or the emotion that you feel in your body when you encounter that artwork. So yeah, alt text as poetry is a really beautiful offering from and for the community. And I would say just practice if you're nervous about, quote unquote, getting it right. I would encourage everyone, you know, on your personal social accounts. So if you post something on your personal Instagram, get in the habit of writing that alt text every time. It's a good move as an ally, as someone who is seeing. And it's also just really awesome practice to find your voice as someone who writes alt text, which I think is a discrete, almost genre of writing at this point, that I would encourage every artist and every person who participates online to get in the habit of using.
Thank you so much, Kayla. I hadn't heard of that resource before. You all brought it up in your audit materials, so I'm glad to hear that it's something that other people can access as well if they're interested. Did anyone else want to add anything onto that before I go on to my last question that I had prepared?
I'm good.
Awesome. Okay, so I guess to kind of bring us closer to the end of this conversation, the consultation and some of the things that we've talked about today, you know, really looked at things like closed captions, ASL interpretations, image descriptions, voiceover software, video relay services, having strong contrasting visuals in designs, website navigation. Like, these are all very prescriptive things when we're talking about digital accessibility. But I think, you know, a lot of people listening to this might know, or I hope they know, that accessibility is so much more than that, right? It's so much more than websites, and you've all kind of spoken to that already as well. So I was curious to just kind of open up the scope of the conversation at this point in relation to anything that you want to share, really, in relation to systemic barriers. Access to technology is a big one, the needs of individuals of different abilities, genders, circumstances. I'm curious if anyone would be willing to just expand on this idea of access in the broadest sense, or to speak to, like, what else is it that arts organizations should be paying attention to on their digital accessibility journeys? And yeah, I think maybe all of this relates to a term that you brought up as well, disability justice. So I know that's kind of like a lot of questions all in one, and feel free to respond to that however you wanted, however you'd like, but I thought it would be interesting to just open up the conversation at this point.
I have a thought ready to go here. So a lot to take in, but I think in terms of disability justice, yes, that really does tie into accessibility. And it's political, right? I mean, providing food, for example, to the community, that's a political act right there, right? So, I mean, our governments do not provide enough resources for people. So artists are having to take on the onus to feed people, right? So that there's definitely some politics behind this when we consider this. My hope for AGGV and other organizations as well, in terms of, you know, making sure accessibility is there, you know, yes, there's certain things you want to do, and yes, you want to implement those, and then maybe in 3 months we'll revisit. And I realize that it can become a list of checkboxes and everything, but I think the ultimate goal is it becomes habitual so that, you know, organizations have accessibility built in there with their institutions, and that these institutions are functioning higher now. Right. And the experience to be an ally and a voice for the disabled, you know, the advocates involved with the politics behind this. And so really, you know, lobbying governments for, you know, legal change, for example, that would really, you know, really tighten up what's all organizations have to do, that we have a higher standard of expectation and now everyone has to do it. To see those kinds of changes would be nice for the disabled community, for myself and for Tangled Arts, you know. And so, you know, you kind of get used to after a while, you're always lobbying, you're always, you know, you show up at meetings, you know, you're giving presentations. And so we want that to continue. But I think if other organizations are doing it as well, you know, they might not have disability as part of their name, right? They're just, for example, they're just part of the greater Vancouver area, whatever it might be, but having other people come and show up and talk about this, and we really believe in this, and this is important, this is change that needs to happen. You know, once word gets out, I think it's going to go viral, and we need that support there too. And we really, you know, it, being political, it will affect elections. You will see people talk about it. So I just think that's definitely part of my thoughts here. So that's kind of the first half of my thought process as I'm working my way through it here. I'm also thinking about digital and online access, you know, news articles and whatnot here. I'm starting to get a feeling of it's a little bit, there's some dread for that, for it. And let me explain why I have that feeling. One of the concepts now that is being spread out there is metaverse. The metaverse, all right? So that concept is out there. So this idea of, you know, really networking, looking at a global response and, you know, being able to see and access that, right? And we can actually, like, it's basically a lens to view our own world with. And, you know, it's, the world might not be what you think kind of thing. So everyone's talking about the metaverse right now, right? And I just think it's going to grow. It's only going to get bigger and bigger and bigger. And at the same time, I think, you know, those in the disabled community often get left behind, and we're almost ready for it. We're expecting this. We haven't seen any discussions about how to bring us on board, right? So if you're meeting a deaf person, right, and you might be a million miles apart, whatever it is, and you want to engage online and talk to each other and share parts of the world, how are they going to understand each other? One person's deaf, the other one speaks. How do I make that communication happen? Do they sign? Do they know any sign? No one's even talking about this. You know, as viral as this is, it's happening, but no one's talking about it, right? And I mean, look at captioning, for example. I mean, even like 30 years ago, that wasn't a normal practice, right? And there's no laws for it even to provide that accessibility. And that's in all of North America. So we're constantly fighting just for basic captioning to have online now. And now this new metaverse is taking off, and we can already see where this is going to go. I think we need more voices out there from our communities to really push for this now. And as this, as the metaverse grows, accessibility grows with it. So I'm just kind of unfiltered letting this out here. So I'm just hoping that some food for thought for people out there is think twice, actually, right? So this way we have the right lens as we go forward.
I think that was beautifully put, Connor. I mean, I think access is political work. And what you're saying about the metaverse makes me think about just, you know, the idea of critical access kind of, which was a concept put forward by Amy Hamerai, really helps us to understand that, like, oftentimes the idea around accessibility is that unless it benefits everyone, it doesn't make economic sense. And I think we need to move away from that. Like that's that understanding that, oh, if it only benefits my bottom dollar, then I'm going to implement access. But we really need to move away from that way of understanding accessibility and have to really be able to trouble this neoliberal concept that access, you know, has to always be this kind of universal good that benefits everyone. I think deaf and disabled folks need access, and we take it up as this never finished project that is always evolving, that's always changing, and is always dependent on our relationships with one another. You know, it's a really co-designed process, and it might not be always easy or cost effective, but I think it is human. And I think it does give us a better understanding of how we can create care in our community that's really in a community that's really shifted away from that, in a community that's only ever seen, or like in a capitalist society that's only ever seen us as our production and as the dollar signs that we can bring in. I think disability justice is really the antidote to capitalism in some ways. And so I think what you're bringing up, particularly in the metaverse, which is like this highly capitalist sort of development without any sort of, or at least it seems there's no consideration for disabled folks, right? Deaf, mad, disabled folks at all. And so I think, you know, we all need to have a better, more critical and political understanding of access, because the choices we make when we're creating access really goes beyond just the audiences that are being served and the artists that are being served, but it's actually a political statement on how it is that we understand the systems that make up our world. And it goes kind of meta, but I feel like the question you asked was very meta. So, yeah, that's the end of my thought.
Hey, this is Frances speaking. Yeah, what both of you are saying is really reminding me of, so in disability justice, there are these 10 principles that are set forward. And one of them is collective liberation. And so in the words of Sins Invalid, the collective that kind of has put forward these 10 principles, it's no body or mind can be left behind. And only moving together can we accomplish the revolution we require. So I think a lot of the time, at least I've seen sometimes, like institutions or galleries will be accessible in some ways and still wondering why disabled folks aren't showing up. And I think sometimes the reason behind this can be that political element is being left behind. I don't think that we can truly be spaces that are committed to disability justice if we're not also interrogating the ways that we are behaving on stolen land, and, you know, thinking about the ways in which we are or are not being like meaningfully anti-racist, and things like that. Like those are elements that sometimes don't enter the conversation, I think, in ways that they really need to, in order for justice to really be like a word that's being used, as opposed to just like we are a space that uses captions. You know, like I think those are two really different things that sometimes get talked about in the same way.
I absolutely agree with everything you've all said, and that was the reason for this kind of very meta question, as you put it, Sean. I think there's a lot of learning and unlearning to do. Like this whole conversation seems to be linked back to how can we decolonize our spaces? How can we queer our spaces? How can we make our spaces accessible? And I mean that in the digital sense as well, right? Because digital doesn't automatically mean accessible. And those ableist structures, those inaccessible structures, they definitely exist in digital space too. And there are just as many access barriers in digital spaces as in physical ones. So yeah, thank you all so much for your willingness to share and just reflect on this process. I'm trying to figure out how to say this in a way that doesn't make it feel like it's the end, because this was like a mini digital accessibility audit, but it was just the start, right? Like, this is a journey. And I think that's something that we've tried to emphasize throughout the project, is that we want to continue to work with all of you and to continue to build access in different ways. And so this is not the end, this is just a bit of a reflection point along the way. So I really, really appreciate all of you being willing to share your thoughts and your time.
Thank you so much, Kayla, Sean, Francis, and Connor, for sharing your thoughts with us today. And thank you to all of our listeners for tuning in to another episode of the WIP podcast. This podcast series is generously supported by a Canada Council for the Arts Digital Now grant. For those who want to learn more about this podcast or other AGGV projects and programs, head over to aggv.ca. And visit our YouTube channel to check out WIP podcast episodes with ASL interpretations and captions.